it is now time to begin solving the hydrogen atom. Now, this is usually one of the core subjects in any quantum mechanics course. It usually also is quite difficult for the student because the procedure is not easy. So we want to make sure to go through it step by step. I'm going to make several videos just to make sure that you can just go into whichever video talks about the topic that you're interested in. And that way you don't have to just try to get through a massive video where everything is being explained at once. So the hydrogen atom is just basically solving the potential where we have an electron orbiting a proton. That's the basis. So it's basically going to be solving the Schrödinger equation, but in three dimensions. And the potential is now going to be the Coulomb potential, because there's going to be this electric attraction between the electron and proton. Okay, so that means how do we begin solving this? Well, as I said, first we must write down the Schrödinger equation, but this time it's not going to be just second derivative with respect to x. This time we are in three dimensions, so we need to generalize this to three dimensions. Now, what this is going to be exactly does depend on our choice for coordinates, but in general, we usually write this just as the Laplacian. And this is going to be basically what before used to be just this derivative. So we're going to have the Laplacian acting on our wave function, which now is going to depend on whatever coordinates we choose. It might be x, y, z, depending on the problem. In this case, we are dealing with a problem that has spherical symmetry, because we expect that the potential only depends on distance. It shouldn't depend on the angle. So it's going to be very interesting and easier if we just pick the coordinates. We are the distance between the electron and the proton, then some angle theta and phi, which are just the usual angles that we see in spherical coordinates. Then we're going to get plus the potential. That's only going to depend on r. I'm going to set it in later when we actually solve the radial part of this. And this is going to multiply psi of r theta phi. And this is going to be equal to e psi of r theta phi. So this is how we set this up. The question now is, well, what is going to be the Laplacian? Because we have to find this wave function, the potential we already know. So the Laplacian is actually going to be what we need to find. Since we are in spherical coordinates, we need to write the Laplacian in spherical coordinates. Now, that is a procedure that you may have seen before in some of the maybe mathematical methods courses that you may have taken, or maybe in electromagnetic theory, because it does appear there as well. I'm not going to be covering it here because it's really more of a mathematic thing than a physics thing, how to derive this Laplacian. If there is a lot of interest, I might make a video on that. But for now, I'm just going to consider that we know it. So the Laplacian is just this right here. I'm going to go through it in a second. So the Laplacian is just 1 over r squared partial with respect to r of r squared partial with respect to r plus 1 over r squared sine theta partial with respect to theta of sine theta partial with respect to theta plus 1 over r squared sine squared times partial squared with respect to phi squared. So that's the Laplacian. I hope you have seen it before. If not, just work with it, or maybe pause the video and go see the derivation if that is useful to you. So now we want to plug this into our Schrödinger equation, and we're going to want to solve it. So when we do that, we get minus h bar squared minus 2m, and now we put in this right here. Control C, Control V. There we go. And all of this is going to be acting on psi. So then we're going to have plus. I'm going to, for now, leave out this r of theta phi dependence just to save some room. But please keep in mind that this wave function depends on those three variables. This is going to be equal to e psi. So how do we solve this? Now comes our crucial step that I think we did it once before when we were dealing with one equation that we had to separate the variables. So what we do here is we say, okay, so let us look for solutions of the form psi equals some function of the radius multiplied by some function of the angles. And for now, we are going to leave both theta and phi together. And later on, we are going to do separation variables again inside of this y function. And there we're going to separate this theta and phi. So this is going to be what we call the radial equation. And this is going to be what we call the angular equation. And I'm going to make separate videos on those topics later. For now, we just want to separate these equations. Okay, so how do we do that? Well, let's just plug this into what we have found here. So I'm going to go to the next slide. Let's see, just want to make sure I'm not covering anything up. I think that's exactly right. Okay, so now let's just replace these psi's by ry. And we can actually multiply through. So we're going to have over here ry. Then we got an ry right here. Let me see if I can move this slightly. And get rid of this line. And one ry still here. Oh, I forgot to put back the parentheses over there. One second. Right here. And this psi is going to be ry as well. And same with this last one over here. Okay. So now let's take a look at these derivatives. So this derivative right here is only with respect to r, but this big r function depends on r, while this y function does not. The angular part depends only on theta and phi. That means that this is basically a constant when we look at it from the perspective of r, so we can just pull it up front here, so we get y. Now here, this r is going to be what is a constant because it doesn't depend on the angle, so the partial derivative does not affect it, so we can just write it up here. And similarly here, the r does not depend on phi, so we can just go ahead and write it here. Okay, so now what is our goal? What are we trying to accomplish here? So wait, by the way, I'm missing this bracket here. There we go. So what we are trying to accomplish is we want to separate our variables. That means we want to put everything that has an r together and everything that does not, put it somewhere else. Okay, so that's our goal here. And what do we need to do to accomplish it? Well, we have this annoying r squared here, which is in this theta part, and it shouldn't be there. And it's also here in the phi part, and it shouldn't be there either. And also we have this y, which is inside of the r part, so it shouldn't be there. And we have this big r, both in theta and in phi. So we need to get rid of all of those things. So let us then divide by both the r function and the y function. Because when we do that, we are going to, well, here, it's just going to be 1. Same here, it's just going to cancel out. And here, this r will cancel out. But we will also have a y dividing down here. Similarly here, this r will cancel out. And since we're dividing by both r and y, we will also get a y down here. And similarly, this y will now cancel out. And we will have this time an r down here. And we still have to deal with this r squared. So let us now multiply all of this by r squared. E r squared. So this r squared right here is going to go away. I think I need to make my eraser smaller. Same with this. This is now going to cancel out. And this one over here is going to cancel out as well. So now that we have done that, let's see that this term only depends on r. This here only depends on the angles. And well, we still have this, which we need to move around a little bit. So to do that, let us put the energy, because both of these have an r squared term, so let's put them together. Let's put them both on the left side, so we can put it together with this r part. And let's also divide by this term right here. So when we do that, we get 1 over r d by dr r squared dr dr, and then we got plus, well, and now we want to put all of our radial things together. So we are dividing by this, and it's multiplying these two things here. So we get minus 2m divided by h bar squared, and we can factor out the r squared. So we get v, which is a function of r, minus e. And now we can just go ahead and write the rest of our angular part. So we get, and we can actually factor out 1 over y sine theta, just to make it a bit easier to write. So this is going to be multiplying d theta sine theta d by d theta y plus, and this is going to be 1 over sine theta d squared multiplied to phi squared y, and this has to be equal to 0. So this is the equation that we get when we do this separation of variables, because just to make sure that it's clear, I'm going to put one more bracket here. So this left part is going to be only depending on the radius, on r, on the distance r, which is this radial distance. And this right part only depends on the angles. So that means that each one of these is a constant when you look at it from the perspective of the other, because this does not change whenever the angles change, and this part right here does not change whenever the distance between the electron and the proton change. Obviously, in this case, we haven't really discussed anything with regard to the this being a proton and an electron. We have not said anything about the hydrogen atom yet. This is just the Schrödinger equation in spherical coordinates. So basically, whenever you're going to be dealing with something that has a spherical symmetry, you're going to have these two same equations. And actually, the difference is only going to come when we solve the radial equation. The angular one will be exactly the same regardless of your potential. That's actually quite interesting. So, well, now this part right here, as I said, is a constant. So let us just give it a name. In the textbooks, it's usually called L times L plus 1, because that appears naturally later on. So just to save time, they say, okay, just call this. But as I have said before, I don't like doing that. I think that we should go by it step by step. So I'm just going to call this K, just in a naive way. Supposedly, I don't know what's going to happen. So if we're solving this for the first time, it might make sense to just call it K, because we don't know what's going to happen. So let's not call it L times L plus 1 just yet. We will do that later. But for now, we're just going to say, okay, this is just a constant. Let's just call it K. And because this plus this has to be equal to 0, then this has to be minus K, so that when we add them together, we get 0, which is what we expect. So let us now write this separately, right? So it's going to be 1 over r, actually, we don't really need to write it as partial now, because this only depends on r squared dr dr minus 2m r squared h bar squared vr minus e, and this has to be equal to k. And now similarly, well, I'm just going to copy this, to be honest. I don't really know why I wrote it in the first place. Okay, and this right here is our angular equation, which is actually going to be the first one of these two that we attempt to solve. And well, this is not going to be equal to 0. This is going to be equal to minus k. So as I said, this part is the radial part. This part is the radial equation, angular equation. And then the next video, we are going to begin solving the angular equation. So I will see you then.